Good morning.
Good morning.
Great to be back. I had a fantastic break this summer with Dana, and we kind of had a staycation where we stuck around here since we now have two grandbabies. And so we've been sticking around, kind of helping with that. And we are in this series called Greenhouse. In fact, we're going to finish it up tonight with the Law 7 that goes with it. But before we do that, could you do me a favor? Get your handout out. I have a favor for you to ask of you, and you're going to have to write something down to do to accomplish it. So get your handout out, and this is what it is. We've got a guy on our staff here in our facilities team that helps set up the chairs and does the work around here to kind of behind the scenes, and he's been working here for a few years, and it's just recently that he has decided that he wants to consider vocational ministry, which is incredible since he got to see us up close that he would still try that. But anyway, but he has decided to enroll and go into Bible college. And now, here's the deal. The Bible college that he enrolled in does this weird thing. I think it's weird. They have a video contest at the first of the year in the summertime, and whoever gets the most likes on their video gets their tuition for the coming year paid for free. So he's in this competition, and I just heard about it because I've been gone, and I here's what I need you to do. I asked, is this cheating? You know, he said, no, it didn't say anything about not, you know, you couldn't get your church to help you. So right away, I'm like, and I'm in this. I'm competitive. I'm like, we got to win this sucker for him. So here's the deal. I want you to write down, here's what you, go to YouTube and do a search and search Jason Hodges testimony. Not just Jason Hodges, but Jason Hodges testimony. Okay? Then I want you to go on there, and you don't have to watch the video if you don't want to. But you have to like it, because that's what they count. They count not views, but likes. And so you need to click. Just viewing it's not enough. You got to click on the like. All right? So we ought to be able to, I mean, I don't know what everybody else has got behind them, but I figure if a lot of y'all would help with this, in fact, all of you would help with this, then we ought to be able to get this done, and we ought to, he's about 10 votes behind. Last I checked. So let's smoke it. Let's get this kid's college. Come on, a kid's college paid for the first year. All you got to do is get on and like it. If you're not willing to do that, change churches. Okay. All right. Good to have me back, huh? All right. Let's pray. Let's pray and we'll get started. Father, it is good to be back, and it is good to be in your house with your people centered around your teaching. And so as we gather, we thank you for our freedom. We thank you for the resources that you provided for us that we might enjoy this time. And we ask, God, Holy Spirit, please come and teach us. We're going to deal with a difficult topic and one that gets us stuck a lot. And unless you help and intervene, we're just going to spin our wheels here. We beg you, please, be our teacher. Get me out of the way. Empower your word that we might see what you have for us this morning. We ask that, God, that you would be pleased with our fellowship and that it would exalt Christ and that your reputation would be enhanced. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. On your handout there, since you've got it out, you can see that I listed the laws that we've worked through, and I'm grateful for the team to kind of help us work through these laws. But here's our law, Law 7 for today. We cannot do anything about last year's harvest. We cannot do anything about last year's harvest, but we can do something about this year's. As I was thinking about this, I thought about in my own past, what were some regrets that I had, some things in, that got me stuck in my past. And I want to share one with you that's it happened a long time ago, and it's pretty trivial, actually. And then a second one that's a little more recent that's more painful. But the first one is this. I know it's hard for you guys to believe, but I once was young and went to college and had hair and things like that. In fact, here I am in college. That's me on the left there. And that's actually my little brother on the right, who is twice as big as me. And that's my wonderful mom. God bless her. And she's escorting us off of the football field at one of the parent days there while I was in school. And that's enough. Thanks. And I can't concentrate with that up there, so thank you. So I was privileged to be able to play football for the 4 years that I was in school. And during my junior year, I had a pretty good year. And I received a lot of postseason awards for the year that I had. And so going into my senior year, you know how this is my last year. I'm going to really prepare. I'm going to work hard during the off season. I'm going to go into this, and I'm going to just do the very best I can. And at the first of my senior year, the team elected me as one of their captains. It was a great honor. And then the first two games of this football season, my senior year, I played probably my best two games ever. I mean, I made some plays that I wouldn't normally make. I think God intervened and helped me. I don't know if there is divine intervention on the football field, which I doubt. But I just played fantastic. And at the second game, after the second game, we had three starters on our defense, and I was on the defense. Three starters on our defense got hurt. And I made up my mind when those three starters got hurt that I was good enough to play my position and their position too. Now, if you know anything about football, you know that the minute you start trying to play someone else's position, you are in deep trouble. And for the next 8 games, I played terrible. I made mistakes I wouldn't normally make. I cost us touchdowns that I wouldn't have normally cost us. I mean, I played terrible. All that time, I'm stuck in the past of what I had accomplished in the past. And that, looking back on those good things that I had done, so inflated my ego. And I played with such arrogance that I just stunk. I went, and this is the Letterman's plaque that they award to each athlete at the school that I was at. And it shows the years that I lettered in football and the other sports. And then it says, my junior year, it lists the awards that I got, where I was all conference and I was actually all American. And then it has my senior year, and all it says beside it is captain. All of the hype, all of the expectations, all of the dreams about being this, of going further with what I had accomplished, was completely washed because I had fixed my eyes behind me on what I had accomplished, and I thought that that would carry me through to the next year. Now, that happened a long time ago, and honestly, it's not very important. I could barely find this. I had to look a long time to find the plaque. But more recently, I've been gripped with the kind of regret that almost paralyzed me. In Thanksgiving of 2011, Clay, our youngest son, was scheduled to come home and spend Thanksgiving with us. And because of work and some other things, he didn't come. And so we made sure, okay, but for sure you're going to be here at Christmas. You know, Mom wants to do some things special at Christmas, and you're going to be here. Yes, I'll be there for sure. And then he didn't come. He didn't make it at Christmas. And at Christmas, Dana and I thought, why don't we just go on up to him and see him? Why don't we just drive on up to Eugene? We'll get a chance to see him. We had bought him a guitar for Christmas. Why don't we just take the guitar and surprise him? And we almost did it. We just almost did it. And then we decided, no, what we'll do is we'll call him and we'll say, Clay, we're going to send you some money. We'd like for you to come in February. We're going to do a family ski trip up at Tahoe. We'll send you the money. And rather than use our money to come up to see you, we're going to send you the gas money and all that so that you can come down and join us and Josh and Jen and Coles as we go on the ski trip. He said, that's a great idea. Mom and Dad, we'll do that. And he couldn't come. And then you know that it was the next month, March 22nd of 2012, that he physically died with plans of coming that very week to see us. Unless you've had that kind of regret in your life, I can't explain it to you how much it hurt. And the guilt and the shame of not going to see him that Christmas dominated me for at least a month. It dominated me. It was during that time that I told Dana, I'm not sure I'll ever stand in front of Westgate again. I'm not sure I'll ever be able to. And the voices in my head of telling me what a lousy father I was, and that you could have done something. Why didn't you go? You could have done something. It would have changed things. The shame that began to kind of envelop me is really difficult for me to communicate. But here's what I'm counting on. What I'm counting on is that there's lots of people in the room that understand what I'm talking about. There have been things in your life that have hurt so bad looking back on them that they've almost paralyzed you. And it is that kind of shame, that kind of regret, that kind of looking back. This is not a proverb. This law is not sometimes true. This is always true. We can do nothing, not one single thing about last year's harvest. In fact, on the bottom of your handout, you'll see that Jesus spoke directly about this. Now, in Luke 9, best we can figure, he's about 6 months away from the cross. So he knows that his time is drawing near, and he tells his followers towards the last half of this chapter that, hey guys, I'm going to get arrested and they're going to kill me. And then he goes on to say, there's some dangers in following me. There's some dangers here. You think you're going to gain position? You're going to lose position. You think you're going to gain privilege? You're going to lose privilege. You think you're going to gain power? Power is going to be taken away from you. There's some dangers about following me. And then as if he kind of wants to up the ante, he says, here's the cost. Here's the cost of following me, beginning in verse 57. And he says, basically, there's some things you can't hang on to. And by that, what he means is that you can't put them in first place anymore. You want to be mine? You want to follow me? It's not just an intellectual assent that says, I believe this to be true. That's not enough. It's a surrender to him. It's a commitment to say that the first place belongs to him in my life. And the first thing he says is that you can't hang on to your stuff. And there's nothing wrong with having good stuff. There's nothing wrong with having a nice car, living in a great zip code, having good vacations, having a nice watch. None of those things are wrong in and of themselves. Not a single thing, unless you try to put them in first place. And then they become idols. Then he goes on to say in the next session, you can't hang on to relationships. And what he means there is there's nothing wrong with great relationships with your spouse or with your boyfriend or girlfriend or with the friends that you have or your children. They should be important. We're hardwired. Part of being image bearers of God is that we're made for relationship. But he says, you cannot put those people in first place. Only one person can go there. Nothing wrong with those folks. It's good to have good relationships unless you put them in first place. And if you do, they're idols. And then the verse that speaks to us is he says you can't hang on to your stuff, you can't hang on to relationships, and you can't hang on to your past. You can't take the things of your past and so elevate it and romanticize it because it was so good that it gets into first place, or so be paralyzed and captivated by it that it's shameful that it goes into first place and it's all you think about. He goes on and says it this way. Anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back, watch this, is not fit for the kingdom of God. Because anyone, man or woman, boy or girl, anyone who's got their focus in first place on things that have happened in the past, they are not able to do the things that God has for them. You're not fit. You can't hang on to it. You can't live a life looking back like this. And you think, well, it's not that big a deal to look back a little bit while you're plowing, unless you get just a little bit off. And then if you get a little bit off, then your next row is off, and the next row is off. And before long, five or six rows out, you're way off. Jesus would say, you can't live life looking backwards. And I would say, okay, I mean, I guess we would all say, sure. But how the heck do you do that? How do you live that? How do you live it when the past is so great and now so crummy? Or how do you live it when the past is so painful that you can't help but be reminded about it all the time? Now, maybe there's a day coming. Maybe there's a day coming when I'll be able to speak to this more authoritatively. Right now, all I've got is what's helping me. I'm in process. So what I want to do is just take you to what's helping me. If that's fair, if you think, well, I need an expert, but then, you know, take a nap. Take a nap. We'll wake you in a minute. It's because all I can share with you really is the process that's helping me today. And it's in Philippians chapter 3. So why don't we turn there together. On your handout, it'll also be listed there. How do I start living this kind of life? How do I start living in such a way where I can say no to the things that are behind me and be freed from them? Well, Paul in chapter 3 of Philippians, he actually starts out by doing kind of what I did with the football story. He talks about all of the things from his past that were really, really good. He says, man, you talk about, I was born right. I'm out of the right tribe, out of the right families. And immediately, even by the eighth day, I began keeping the law. I did things right. Not only was I born right and began right, but I was educated right. I had just the right teachers that were in the... And then from that, I had the right kind of influence. And I was in with the movers and shakers. And not only that, but the things that I thought were most important, I gave my full soul to it. I brought full zeal to it. And then he says the most amazing thing. Verse 8. Is it verse 8 or verse 7? Let me look. Verse 8. He said, for Christ's sake, I have discarded everything else. Watch this. Counting it all as garbage. That's the way the NLT translated. Counting it all as garbage. This word literally means human excrement. It's the word in Greek, skubala. It's as close as Paul gets to saying, you know, the thing that happens? He says, I look back on all of those good things that I thought would impress God, all the things that I thought were gaining me favor and making me righteous. I count them all doo-doo. I look on them as something that you wouldn't ever touch. Unless, of course, you have a newborn. And then he says, and this is what I do. This is how I kind of move forward this. He says in verse 12, I don't mean to say that I've already achieved all these things or have already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it. But I focus on this one thing, forgetting the past, looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. I do this. I haven't done it yet. I haven't made it yet. But I forget what has gone on in the past, whether it's good that I thought might gain me favor or the bad. Remember this. Paul not only had in his past all of those achievements that he thought was gaining him righteousness, but he also had accomplices to murder. He also had families that had been completely wrecked and split apart. He also had churches that had been destroyed, pastors that had been arrested, followers of Christ that had been scattered because of his zeal before he came to know Christ. And in the midst of that, he says, I'm doing my best. I haven't achieved it yet. I'm doing my best to forget that and move this way. Now, as you look at this, there's lots of applications, but let me just kind of draw your attention to four of them. The first one that stands out right away is that this old process is exactly that. It's a process. Embrace it. Stop living with this unrealistic expectation that things are supposed to happen quick. We live in such an immediate gratification culture, an instant gratification that surrounds us, that we sometimes believe that our faith should move at that same pace. There is no microwave to speed up the faith development in you. And for some of us, the process is really long because we had a long way to go. We just had a long way to move towards Jesus. Embrace it. It's a process. Listen to what Paul said over in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. He said, therefore, we don't lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. That we don't lose heart if we understand this, because we know we're being renewed day by day, a little bit by a little bit. Now, this does not mean that as you're in this process, that you shouldn't look back and gain some insight. I'm not saying that you shouldn't examine your past. An unexamined life is wasted. I'm not saying that there shouldn't be principles that you get. You shouldn't get feedback. Looking back on my senior year and years to come has been valuable for me, because here's the deal. Praise and popularity, it's kind of like chewing gum. It's okay to chew on it a little bit, but don't swallow. What I have in my heart, the dark side of my character is, I tend to swallow. I tend to swallow it up and believe it. And that's something for me to be warned about. It's something that I should examine, because I don't ever want to waste a year again. I don't want to do that ever again. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't look back on some things. I'm not saying you shouldn't admit some wrongs and make amends when it's needed. Listen, some of y'all, that you know, you're walking by your garage and you're seeing that rake that belongs to your neighbor in your garage every day. Just take the rake back. Give it back. I mean, you're thinking, oh my gosh, I need to pray harder for my neighbors because he never talks to me. It's because he thinks you're a thief. Take the rake back. This is not hard. We're over-spiritualizing this. If you look back and you say, well, I owe somebody some money, pay them. Well, I misspoke. I told a lie. Make it right. Listen, for me, there was a time here where I once gathered the staff together and I was telling them I had read some books in the previous year. They asked me what I'd read. I said, here's the books I had read. And as soon as the meeting was over and I got back to my office, I realized that wasn't true. You didn't read all those books. And I started arguing with God. I said, yeah, but God, I started them. You know, I started them all. And he said, that's not what you said. He said, you read them. So I had to call the staff back, and I said, hi, my name's Steve, and I'm a liar. You know? And man, it was hard. I was like, I wrestled with God about all the justifications. No, maybe I could just do it in email. He said, no, bring them all back. Tell them what you've done. Now, here's what I'll tell you. Here's what I learned. I'm going to think twice before I lie again to my staff. Because that was so hard. It was so hard. You say, well, I don't want to take that rake back. I've had it now for 2 years. He's probably already replaced it. It doesn't matter. Shut up and take the rake back. Make it right. Because making it right will also make it harder to do it again. So I'm not saying that you don't, when it says I forget the past, I'm not saying that you don't examine what's gone on. You use some of the things, you make the wrongs right. It's not what I'm saying. But this is a process. It's a process. Embrace it. Lower the expectations of some microwave faith super duty pill that's going to make you like Jesus in a day. It ain't going to happen. I know the dudes on TV say it will if you'll just send them money, but they're lying. Okay? It's a process. Embrace it. Next, you're forgiven. Accept it. Let me read you some scriptures. 1 John chapter 1, but if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all our wickedness. Titus 3, but when God our Savior revealed his kindness and love, he saved us not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy, he washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and a new life through the Holy Spirit. Listen, if you have never embraced the gift of Jesus Christ by faith, I would implore you, embrace him. He has died and loves you, and he rose from the dead to show you that he offers you eternal life. Embrace him so that you can have this forgiveness. But you who are in Christ, you must also accept this over and over again and stop listening to the voices inside of you of condemnation and shame and guilt. Romans 8, chapter 1 and 2, or chapter 8, verses 1 and 2 says, now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ. Because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed us from the power of sin that leads to death. By refusing to dwell on the past and giving it first place, you say no to the voices that are lying about shame and guilt, and you replace them with the voices of truth from the Scriptures. You do not allow yourself to stay there. You are forgiven. And by dwelling on that past and not accepting that forgiveness, you are basically making you the center of your universe instead of Christ. And that's taking that past and putting it in first place instead of allowing Jesus to be there. That's why this is so critical. Because, yeah, it hurts. We make mistakes. Yes, all of those things are true. But we can get stuck there and we can waste days, weeks, months, years in our past. And Jesus never intended that for us. Men and women, Jesus never intended us to live our lives that way. You say, well, it just doesn't go away. Just as it comes up, I get it. Again, I'm in process, remember? I get it. As it comes up, I remind myself, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. It wouldn't have changed anything to go and see my son. What happened would have happened. It had just made me feel better. Okay. Third, life is a struggle. Expect it. Life is a struggle. Expect it. John 16, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. And here's a promise from Christ. In this world you will have trouble. But take heart. I have overcome the world. The language that Paul uses here is language of an athlete straining towards. He says, I forget the past and I strain towards it. And it's literally the picture of an athlete reaching for the finish line. Here's a picture of one who the guy there on the right is just like everything just to try to reach out and get there before that guy in the blue who says, no way, dude, I got it. You know, another picture here where they're straining. They're risking falling on their face as they throw all of their weight forward to try to be the first to cross that line. It's a struggle. It takes concentration. You have to have an orientation where you know where you're aiming. Here's another one here. Oh, how'd that get in there? Perhaps it's because that's the only touchdown they scored last year. How about another one? So right here, an athlete. an athlete is just taking every ounce of his athleticism to be able to contort his body in such a way where he's reaching the ball over there, over the goal line. I think you've got a couple of more here. Some bikes where they would just throw the wheel, not the person, is what crosses the line first. And so they will throw the bike out in front, way out in front of them, trying to be the first to cross. And I think we've got one more here, our very own Dan Perkins, straining during an Ironman here as he pushes forward. Trust me, he doesn't look like it, but he's straining. And his wife tells me he's stinking about now too, so okay. So it's a struggle. It's a struggle. Expect it to be hard. Expect it. And then finally, there's a goal. Pursue it. Almost every commentator on this section in Philippians chapter 3 agrees that the goal that Paul is talking about is to be ultimately like Christ and to be with him. That the goal is to make Christ and what he is the ambitions of your life. To move in a process of looking a little more like him. That's why years ago we said we're no longer going to call people here to a membership. We need to put the right target on the wall. We need to make Jesus and being like Jesus the right target. We call that 640 discipleship here, that we might love God completely, that we might love our neighbor compassionately, and that we might love one another like Christ loves us. And that we would pursue it. Listen to Hebrews chapter 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge cloud of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, and especially the sin that so easily entangled us. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. Again, this author is using athletic terminology to say it's a struggle. We got to push forward. He says, we do this, we run this race by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. So think of all the hostility that he endured from sinful people, that you won't become weary and give up. You hear that? Where do we get off that this would be such an easy, instant thing? There's nothing in the scriptures that seem to teach that. So we got to introduce ourselves to this process and embrace the process, accepting the forgiveness so that we can turn our away from the things that are in our past, expecting things to be difficult, and then pursuing Christ. One of the things that you could do, and I've had several last night that said they're going to do this, that you could begin, if you've never been baptized as a Christ follower, you could begin today by joining us over at Seabright Beach at 4 o'clock. Come and get baptized and follow in the example of Christ, who left as an example for his followers to do and to be baptized there. Love to have you join us. Make a commitment right now that this fall, I'm going to get in community. I'm going to embrace the kind of processes that will allow me to do this. It's hard. It's difficult, but I'm going to get around some folks and I'm going to move forward in my faith. I'm going to stop making it a one day a week kind of a thing. And I'm going to invite Jesus into the conversation of every single day. Invite him in, asking what it might look like to live like him. Not this past week, but the week before, I was listening to an artist on Spotify, and I don't know if you're familiar with that, but Spotify gives you options. Like you're listening to somebody, and they'll over here on the side, they'll say, these people are like them. And so you can click on another artist that you've never heard of, and I just happened to click on an artist. I didn't know who she was, and I clicked on this artist, and it brought up a song that I thought would be so encouraging to kind of wrap this series up, as this song is about singing about the process of walking with God, the good gardener, pruning and growing and changing to be like Christ for his glory. And so in a minute, Abby's going to come and has agreed to sing it. And as she does, I would just encourage you to say, okay, maybe even look over the laws and say, where is it that I need to embrace? And where is it that I can kind of move forward? And what are the essential steps that I need to make as we begin the fall and kick everything off around here that would really help you in this process? Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. You will reap what you sow. Let us pray. God, thank you so much for the reality of your forgiveness. Thank you for the great hope that is ours in Christ and the way that that love has been expressed so fully. I ask that you would have your way with us, that as we sit and listen, your Spirit would direct us to specific steps that would move us in the process of becoming more like Christ, that your will would be accomplished among us as if it were in heaven, not just so our lives will work, but so that we would be fruitful and obedient to what you are calling us to. May it be for your glory and your splendor. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm so concerned with what I look like from the outside. Will it blossom into what you hope I'll be? And you're so patient just to help me see when blooms come from the deepest seed that you planted in me. Sometimes it's hard to grow when everybody's watching. Have your heart proved by the one who knows best. Although I'm barren cold, I know my season's coming, and I'll spring up in you in this faithfulness. Ooh. With my roots deep in you, I'll grow the branch that bears the fruit. Still be standing in the storm, 'cause I am planted by the river, my streams are living water, and I'll grow up strong and beautiful, all for your splendor, Lord. Don't concern with what I'm leading to your heartbeat. I'm grown with the sound of your voice calling. You're bringing out the beauty that you have put in me, for your joy and for your glory.